I'm Savio Chen. I'm President and CEO of US-China Partners and also the President for the US Pan-Asian American Chamber of Commerce. And our mission is to help Asian minority-owned vendors to find contracts and opportunities for Fortune 500 companies as well as state and federal agencies. And today, I'm the moderator for this panel about procurement, how to get government and corporate contracts, the new rules of engagement. So today, we are very fortunate to have some highly qualified panelists to help us to solve this puzzle of how to get contracts in this tough environment. But the good news is, in this tough economic environment, corporate and government opportunities, there's still a lot of them around, it's available out there. And they will talk about how you can become qualified to be, to access this information, to be a contractor, to get a contract, what do you need to do, and to stand from the crowd to get the certifications, as well as where to get the assistance and resource to help you get contracts. And so again, I would like to have the panelists, when they speak, all come up to the podium here, because they want to record this for future, you know, references. So I just do a lot of walking back and forth between the table and the desk to the podium so they can speak louder, so they can record the better sessions. So I would like each of you to come up to the podium, panelists, to introduce yourself about who you are, what's your organization's name, what do you do, and how you can help our audience to get those information about getting contracts, okay? So first, I would like to ask Walter Maxwell. Walter is the Associate Director of the New York City Small Business Services. So please welcome Walter Maxwell.
Good morning, folks. Good afternoon, I should say. Really, you know, this is such an informal group, you know. What I thought I'd like to do today, you know, I had something really planned. I thought there was going to be thousands of people here. So I really want you to be able to get what you need from here. So really quickly, by show of hands, how many people are in business? Okay. The people who did not raise your hand, have you started your business at all? I mean, have you got a business plan? Have you stopped in? Do you have anything down on paper? Come on, this is interactive, folks. You got to talk to me. Yes? No?
Thinking. Oh.
Okay, so you're thinking, that's what you're talking about. So you're thinking. No, and that's really important because one of the things that you need to do, I always say when you're going into business, the first thing is self-assessment, okay? If you want to come into the city of New York and you want to sell to the city of New York, the first thing you need to do is to do a self-assessment and say to yourself, am I really ready to sell to the city of New York? Because not everyone can come into the city's fold and really be competitive and really sell their product or service to the city of New York. So you really need to do some self-assessment, see if you're large enough, okay? See if you are really want to go through that whole bureaucracy of selling to the city of New York. Anyone can sell to the city of New York. As long as you are a legitimate business, you have a business certificate, you have LLC, a corporation partnership, limited partnership, then you can sell to the city of New York. Out on the table on the outside, I do have some paperwork. So everything that I talk about today is out on the table. But I'm also going to give you something really special today, folks. I'm going to give you how to sell to a government PowerPoint presentation that I came up with that I think can walk you through everything that you need to know about selling to the city, the state, and the federal government, okay, as well to our corporate partners here, even though we all do things differently. But I think there's something that's very generic about everything. Anyone that wants to sell to the city of New York must first have a vendor number. The city of New York registers all their vendors into one major database. And that database is held and operated through our financial services group, through Mayor's Office of Contract Services. So everyone needs to go to www.nyc.gov/sell-to-NYC. And when you get there, basically they ask you some very basic questions, generic questions. Who you are, how much do you, what kind of contracts are you looking for? But the most important thing is question number eight. Question number eight asks, what is it that you do? Folks, we all think we do it all, but we don't. And if we do it all, we don't do it all very well. All right? So you really, really have to decide on what it is that you do and what you can be competitive in. Okay? There are over 98,000 different products or services that the city of New York purchases. You have to choose between your product and your service. You need to get that right in the beginning. Because when you get that right in the beginning, then you start to get the opportunities sent to you that you really can do and or that you can bid on. I'll give you an example. If you do IT services might be commodity code 9000. Well, if that's a commodity code 9000, we have maybe 200 subcategories under it. If you don't open that up and choose the things that you do, then you're going to be getting a whole lot of opportunities sent to you that you don't do. If you don't respond to that after the third time, it will actually kick you out of that particular commodity code. So it's very important, okay, to choose the right commodity code. Choose what you can be competitive in. If you only do it this much, folks, don't put it down because somebody out there does it this much. Okay? What I do, in particular for the city of New York, is I am charged with coming out and finding really able companies like yourself to get into our MWBE certification program, the Minority and or Women-Owned Certification Business Enterprise Program. And when you do that, what we tend to do is once you get certified, it's a six-week process, an application process, we get you certified, but then what we do is we actually give you all the tools that you need in your toolkit to be successful. One of the first things we do is we give you free advertising. We put you in a searchable online directory that helps people on the outside, whether they be city, state, or federal government, whether they be private contractors, whether they be Fortune 500, or whether they be non-for-profits that are looking to do work with you. They can go in, put a keyword in, and they can bring your company up and see that you've been vetted by the city of New York. Okay, so it's like a one-stop portal. And they can be in California, Connecticut, or Canada. It doesn't matter. They can go in and they can access our database. We also give you a procurement counselor. That procurement counselor is the person who helps you to navigate all this, the 80 different city agencies, the 40 different mayor agencies. And each of those agencies procures for themselves the type of products or services that they may need. What they help you to do is they help you to narrow that search down. Because it's important to realize, if you're a construction company, then you don't need to be dealing with an agency that's only purchasing food. Okay? So we try to give you someone that's going to help you to navigate through, you know, all of this red tape and give you the you know, to send you to the agency that you need to be speaking to, and then not only that, but tell you who in the agency you need to be talking to. Now, that's a good thing, okay? I just spoke with a young lady in front of me here, and we had a, you know, a nice conversation, but what she was telling me, she said, well, Walter, you know what I do, and I pretty much know what the agency I need to talk to, but I don't know who in the agency I need to be talking to. Okay, so we're going to help you with that. We're going to help you to narrow that down and get you to what we call that end user, the person who's actually writing the contract. That's very, very important. And it's important to understand that the city of New York procures on three different levels. 5,000 and below, which are micro purchases, which are like one-on-one transactions, basically done on a quote system. You know, I can call you up, I can say, how much can you do it for, you do it for, you do it for. Whoever gives me the best quote, I can take that. Okay. Anything over $100,000 is a competitive sealed bid. There's a start date, there's an end date, and we look for the lowest responsible and responsive bidder. Because the city of New York, as anyone else, is always trying to save money. But we want the person who does it the best to really get that contract. And then those contracts from $5,000 to $100,000 are contracts that you never see, folks, because those contracts are unadvertised. So you need to find out, how do I access that, okay? And hopefully, before you leave out of here today, we'll be able to tell you about how to access those contracts, okay? I want to be available for most of the day, and I think you're going to be asking some questions of us, right?
Yes.
Okay, some questions of us.
Yes.
And you can ask me questions, because I always think that it's better for you to ask me direct questions, and then I can give you an answer to your question, as opposed to going through this whole long, you know, speech about how we do it and what we're doing. Everybody says, what's in it for me, right? You want to know and get the answer to your one particular question. If you get that, then you feel as though your afternoon has been well spent. So I'm going to stop right there, and I'm going to just just be ready for your questions, okay? Thank you.
Thank you, Walter. Well, thank you, Walter. It's very detailed in his presentations. And now the next one I want to bring onto the podium is Mr. K.Y. Chow. Mr. Chow is the president and founder of GM Printing, and he founded in 1993, and he's been getting a lot of contracts successfully over the last, 15 years, maybe, right? 16 and a half years. So he's the poster boy. If you go to the New York City, service department, you see his poster hang over, you get a lot of contracts. So he'll talk about how he navigated the systems and how he can actually get all these contracts, his experience. So, KY, it's all yours.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. It's such an honor for me not to show you how to get into the business contract, but to share a little bit experience as an entrepreneur. First of all, I would like to tell you why my name is KY from GM Printing. Well, I used to tell my friend, because I don't have an English name yet, I get a stable name in Kentucky. The ship start with KY, and also on the jury port about it, KY, so that you can remember me. All right. I come in this country as an alien around 20 years ago. All right. I know nobody. Just told you a background. I'm a merchant banker by professional in a merchant banking facility. Knew nothing about printing. It's a little bit of complicated process. I take over a small company in Chinatown in 1993, with a staff of only 6 persons, in a small store of 850 square foot. 5 years later, in 1997, I was able to move into my premises at Bloom Street, with a total space of 9,400 square foot. And this year, luckily, we were able to move into my new home in Long Island City, Hunter Point Avenue. It's our own building of 18,000 square foot, right? With the help of the federal government and the city, we're able to afford our own building together with 8 color pairs, which is able to do 4 color jobs, front and back. How do I go about business, when we're talking about 1993, we only had 5 people. Well, we start from the very traditional Chinatown business. What you call the traditional Chinatown business is menu. Take our menu for our restaurant. But I'm not happy with that because, we see that, we cannot just follow the old traditional way of doing business because there's no future in the business. You know, that's why I try to grow up the business in a more professional way. I start looking for the government contract. For the time being, I have 4 contracts on hand. The first one is OMDC. The Lower Manhattan Development Corporation. If you are going up to the SBIS office 7th floor, you find my pictures still hang over there because I'm using it's being selected as a prototype of the government contract. Well, in this area, I would like to share our experience how I can get a contract, which is very, very critical. Because when you are able to get the first contract, the second, the third, and the fourth, it's not an issue at all. The second contract I got is a contract from New York City Transit Authority, which is a bankhead contract, including MTA, MTA Bus Company, MTA Long Island Bus Company, LIR Metro Long. It's only limited station of business card only, but it's a 5-year contract. The third one I got is from City Council, which I'm doing all the job for the City Council member, Senator, Speaker, the promotional material. And the last one I just got it last year is New York City Economic Development Corporation, a 3-year contract. To start with, I will try very hard to see why we are talking about our government contract. First of all, what is asking us to do? Certification. Get into the index system, which is very important. Because without that, you can never go into the first step. But when you get the WinDAX system, it's only the start of the nightmare. It doesn't mean that you are able to get any job from them. Okay? So when we're talking about that, we have to get yourself to the P5. In particular, some of the contracts you never have contact before, you have to show them a panel who made a decision to give the contract to you. Well, they are not complicated. They are based on two terms. Number one is your competency. Well, you're able to deliver your commitment to them according to the contract, which is crucially important. Number one. Number two, are you cost competitive? Can you bring them money, saving, which is critically important. Now, let me share you some of the experience how I can get the first contract with OMDC. I get a contract on SMDC in September 11, I mean, there are major disaster over there, you know. SBS is the one who helped me to that. He gave me the leads. Hey, KY, there's a contract coming in, right? Bid on the contract, right? Well, the contract is by the form of RFP, request for proposal. Problem on the RFP is that they don't have a fixed format. Okay? They have some requirement. It's not fixed format. They don't want to have a very lengthy RFP, right? Around 15 pages and 20 pages is good enough already. But within the contract, within the pages, you have to show yourself how you are able to fulfill the expectation, how you are better than your competitor, which is crucially important. Well, imagine a contract like this 5-year contract. Every printer would like to get that. No doubt about that. Is that a lot of money? I can tell you, not too much. There's some profit over there. If you make a mistake, you may be losing money as well. Because everybody would like to get a contract. But again, under the economic situation as we are in a bitter winter, waiting for the next bid, the contract is very important. Because they were able to support the overhead. The ball keep on rolling. Right? So that one is the critical important thing you got to understand. Don't just rely on it, just one contract, two contracts, even at four contracts. I don't rely on it. I mean, it gives you some light belt in some economic downturn like that. Okay, now, let me tell you what I did in getting a contract. I still remember the RFP around 20 pages, right? Well, I am not a native American-born Chinese. When I talk to you, an action below that. I'm no good in competing with American already, okay? Well, but you have to stick to the fact how you're better than them. We are not talking about bullshit business. We are talking about practical business sense. Well, everything got to down to the business. All right? Number one, they would like to see your experience, how good you are. And then I think that you get a lot of good recommendation. Well, you have to figure out who are the good people that can give you good references. Okay? They were able to judge how good you are in terms of delivery, in terms of quality. This is crucially important. How you are able to commit the deliver turnaround time, another factor. How your product is more competitive, right? Well, every business have their own edge, you have to figure out. But the point is that you can write out 16 pages, beautiful wording, you are better than others. How they are going to convince you are better than them, which is very situational. You have to use some skill. All right, of course, I'm talking about the area consideration, you come up with your own proposal, but you have to make use of your own example to convince them. Well, at the time, I'm always thinking, because this is my first contract, how were I able to do that? All right. Well, proposal is nothing new to me because I'm a merchant bank that I used to do proposal, but how do you go still give me a headache, a major consideration? When I look around at the time and I put in a proposal, I get a job here. This job is Chinatown, New York Chinatown travel guide. It's commissioned by American Business Development Corp Center of John Wang. I think if you are familiar with Chinatown, you should know him already. They get a September 11 fund to do this one because at the time the Chinatown is really in a disaster situation. They would like to revitalization of Chinatown by being more tourism. Being a member of Chinatown, ethically, I have an obligation to help my own community, this federation. When John Mann talked to me, I give him a very good price, top bottom price. Okay, he's convinced. He's convinced. But again, my equipment cannot be, may not be better than some of the equipment of 15,000. When I get my proposal accepted by John, already, I don't stop there. I call John. Hey, John, if I were able to help you to save a couple of pennies at the expenses of slight quality, but still very presentable quality, how do you feel? Of course, everybody can. So I start looking for outsource of this job from Midwest. You know that Midwest, for any job, they cannot compare with the operating cost in New York City. Very definitely already, you know. The rental, labor, supply situation. So I was able to get a quotation from Web. And on the other hand, they are using Web. Web is another pinning machine, you know. Lower quality, but very fast, right? When I get a quotation in, it cost me around $20,000, meaning that averaging $1 more. For my price, I quote him at around $17,500, you know? So he have a saving of 12.5%, right? But again, I'm using better quality job because I'm using Shifit rather than Web, okay? Now, I'm taking an edge on this situation. Capitalized the situation in this game. What I did is that I sealed my copy of my quotation to AABDC on the $17,500, okay? And then also made an attachment, an internal exhibit of the web pinning I got from the Midwest government, $20,000. Obviously, there's a fact that I can make them saving. This is true. I am trying to illustrate my diligence, my professional experience to make them saving. Accidentally, when I'm able to to submit the deadline of RFP, I am, because I'm so particular on this job, this is a big job, I don't have any profit margin. That's why I cannot afford any mistake. When I commit a mistake, the entire job will whip me out for losses already. So I'm very particular. So I don't have this sophisticated printing binding material. I have to drop it out to somebody. So accidentally on the same day, well, I demand for a passport for my binding in order to make sure that we are doing the right job. So I was able to get a half-finished folder in from the binder. Okay, let me check out the pages. They don't screw me up upside down, which is very important. Okay, I said, hey, when I push the job in, I also produce a quotation schedule to AABDC. Well, they have only around 10 days to turn around, including. This is very, very tight schedule. Makes sense to me, because, well, the city, OMDC, would like to know that you are able to deliver your job in a timely manner. I also submitted my production schedule by terminal exhibit to them. On the same day, the production schedule have a specific date. On that day, I also get a pen collect copy from them on a particular day. I am 2 days ahead of the very super tight schedule. I made a copy of the pen collect copy, the half-finished copy, right, together with a look from the binder and put it in my proposal. Does it convincing? I guess so, right? After that, it's not the end of the game. And then after I submit a proposal, a week later, I get a quotation request from LMDC. To my surprise, what does it mean, quotation request? I don't get a job yet. I'm not awarded with a proposal yet. Okay? It's on a newsletter. This is the newsletter of OMDC. Of course, for every pinning job, the job specification. You cannot deviate it from your job specification. You're selling that, they're asking for apple, you have to give them apple. You can go give them orange. But when I take a look at the job spec, this is no way to me. Why? By my professional. And when you take yourself as a professional, you don't want just, you know, just to deliver job to the customer. It's asking for. You have to make them that you are expert. You can do better for them. I am delivering my address where you suffer to your gut in order to open up your mind to give you the future, right? What does it mean? It doesn't apply to me. I have no command on the color. They're looking for a three color job, I have to give them a three color job. They're asking for the material. The material they're asking is for French paper. And I take a look at French paper. I'm a little confused. Hey, I know the paper. The paper is very, very expensive paper. But in terms of quality, even I'm a painter. No big deal to me. Just look a little bit short, and even I'm a painter, I can hardly tell a difference.
It's a little French.
It's a little French. French paper. The French paper, the paper mill is called French paper. I'm sorry for that. The paper mill is called French paper. The cost of paper is around $2 per pound. But again, on other similar products, we are talking about 70 cent level. We are talking about one third of the cost. Major difference. We are talking about 50,000 pounds. A lot of saving over there. All right. So I begin reacting responsibly to that proposal, to that production request. So I did my homework and priced it out according to what they are asking for. But again, I'm not stopping there. I made a special note there. Recommendation. I don't think French paper is a great deal for this job. They're designer paper, but again, they don't have particular characteristics. And this is a bulk item. You don't want to spend too much money on paper. Number one, prospect. Number two, the French paper is so expensive. And no paper merchant is going to carry it in the stock. It's not available at all. Every characteristic of newspaper, everybody gets to the last minute. Last minute change, you know. When I was in my contract, I used to be given 2 weeks for a job. Because of the change, I'm screened down to 1 week or even 5 days. When we hit the French paper, the merchant is not going to start it on the floor. What do? We have to wait 2-3 minutes for the delivery from Wisconsin. Does it make sense to me? Definitely not. This is another major, major crucial factor. That's why I made a comment over there. I said, due to this two factor, this is not a good choice for you. Can I recommend a better shape for you? So I make out another shape, which is XMOD. The quality of the paper is more or less the same. Of course, there's difference. But as a professional, I still have a hard time in telling the difference. I have to make it very careful. You know? So it doesn't make sense. Right? So according to my recommendation on the external paper, I make a new set of quotation paper. We're able to bring down the cost to around 20-30% saving. Okay, the most critical factor is that I was able to turn around on the most timely manner because I don't have a problem. Everybody carry it over. That's okay. All right. And then, in the same time, I pick up the phone. Ask my paper supplier, Mr. Lindenmeyer, you have to deliver two different kind of people to LMDC by tomorrow. Special messenger's office at my expenses. The sample, next day when you get a quotation, you have the sample sent by Lindenmeyer, right? They can compare side by side two of different paper. What does it mean to me? I think this is a little bit gimmicky, and factual also. They would like to test you out, how good you are. You just don't say that, hey, you're giving me instructions like that, I just follow that. No, to me, we are human beings. You know, we have an attack to him at the heart, right at the heart. You know, to bring them saving, to bring your tiny manner.
so that you can open up a big vendor like, you don't, like John here, right? This is the way, not only to the government, to everybody. Now, that's the experience I have, you know? So when you are writing a RFP, you got to be very innovative. Think about that. What happened along the side? What happened you can capitalize on some situation, which is a tool for you to open up the market, right? That one is my personal experience I would like to share with you. On the certification, it's a very tedious procedure. It takes months. Now, I still remember that. SBS used to take 6 months. Now, our commissioner have able to do. Using the Small Business Express, they were able to shut it down. They are very good at that. Now, the critical part is that, the way I see it, they only nail it down from to 1 year before it's 3 years. This was a statement, you know? It's 1 year. Very good already. Extremely fabulous. Now, before you say, you know, things, I think two areas you have to keep your eyes open. Number one, on the financial statement. Nobody would like to give the contract to you when you're losing every year. Fat, right? Number two, nobody would like to help you out if you don't pay tax. Okay? There's two exact areas to watch out for. If you are not able to fulfill that, don't take your risk. Wait for another year until your situation improves. Okay? That one is very critical to me. Right? And then you see that even a merchant banker, when we are talking about compilation of the W, nothing. No joke, man. Okay?
It changed so, a little bit there.
No, a little bit better. But still, the problem is that when you hit a mistake, when you come back to me, to you, for we do it, It takes months. So it's really, really annoying. My personal advice to you is that before you submit a document, our commissioner, SBS, what is doing a good job. In the whole country, there are over 20 small business service centers over there. Right? Get to any one of the centers. Get one of the council. Before you submit it, go through your document page by page in order to eliminate a mistake. You know, it helps you out a lot, right? So, lastly, I still would like to see a little bit record on that. When you are able to get the record, get into the contract already, or even you don't have the contract, you have to try to get to know your pin buyer. The any merchandiser, any purchase, they are giving you a job, which is critically important. Now, because the job itself, well, no buyer would like to show them they make a mistake by giving away a wrong contract to you. Okay? So you have to make them feel comfortable. Getting certification doesn't mean that you get a job. You have to get to them. Make them understand what you can deliver. Another experience I would like to share with you, I don't have a contract with a unified cost system of the New York State. It's a cost system down from Manhattan up to Buffalo, the unified cost system. But the printing is being centralized at a minister at 25 Beaver Street, which is the UCA office. I don't have a contract, but now I have a steady business with them. How steady is that? But before I get a first job, it's very difficult. When I'm bidding on an RFP, one of the annual report of the unified cost system, you know, well, I advise to you when you're submitting a bid, you have to spend some time to sit on the bid owner, which is important because you know where you're standing, you know who is the competitor, you know why you are losing. The first annual report I do for the unified cost system, I'm using up high. I didn't get it. I know that my mistake. When you sit on that, you come back and analyze why people can do that. You said my equipment is not cost effective. If you are hitting in this situation, don't waste your time. Concentrate on other contract. You know, if I say that, hey, There's no reason why I am so much higher than that. You ask yourself, okay? You will think that you're still comfortable, okay? Next year, go back to them again, okay? So I did the same thing. I went back to them. You are no bid. You are no bid. When I get the bid at the time, I was able to get it lower. I am the lowest of the bid. I'm happy. I'm the lowest. Hey, I'm going to get this contract. Waiting over there anxiously. But 1 week, 2 weeks, a month. Finally, I was able to get a letter saying that your bid is not awarded. I'm asking why? Why? I'm the lowest on the bid. Why you are not awarded with a bid? Something wrong. So I jump up to the office. He said, hey, you don't show your competency for filling the job. It doesn't mean that the lower bid I can give the job to you. I also doubtful on the quality of the human science office. What do you do? Okay, forget about it. I'm not the kind of guy who sit there, dig into the situation. I said, hey, this is a deadlock situation. I got to open up. Otherwise, you're not able to get the job yourself. All right? So I know that when I meet the officer gave me a business card, the purchasing director, with a title, ESQ, what does it mean? A lawyer. Most of them from the system, they go from the judge, from the law case, they are super conservative. I think that you understand what I'm talking about. Now I'm no problem with my contractor. Why? You take a risk, you know, to ship it to the others. So again, you've got to open up your mind. How do I go open the mind? I start sending them my material. When I get my nice calendar commissioned by my paper mill, I start sending them. When I get a nice directory like this one, I start sending them. And when I get a reward from the pinning award, I send to them. Then let them have a chance to understand your quality. Okay? I'm doing for another year. The third time I'm bidding, I got it. I'm so happy. Now we have a very steady account with OCA office. Well, that one is a lot of hard work. So when you are doing that, I think you have to prepare. It's an uphill battle. It's not just a click, I get a certification. You are able to make your business successful. Right? So, well, whatever experience I was able to share, I wish you guys good luck. And more, well, encouraging you to go into government contract. Especially under the 2005, our mayor had taken care of the minority business. He passed a local law. The local law by 129. The local law specified that the job, all the city job, 20% got to go to the minority. A lot of business. 2006, 2007, I don't feel it at all. I'm still fighting together with other people. But 2008, I feel a little bit different. Every job I got, I have to go through the RIP, fighting together with the other fellow people. But 2008, so different. I start getting a lot of proposals from the agents. Why? Because the mayor office set up a complaint office. Hey, you guys, why? The law is there, 20% got to go. Before the competition is there, I cannot get a qualified minority business to fulfill my job. But now, look, the honeymoon period is gone already. You know, you get to fulfill your honeymoon. Hey, internal printing, you say you cannot get a qualified vendor for the job. How about GM printing? They have in that system. Have you sent them a bid? Have you sent them an invitation? Now, that's the opportunity for us. You know, we are talking about small business. You have to go for that. I wish everybody good luck. Any question? I'm willing to share with you. Thank you.
Thank you, J.Y. Thank you.
Great to have, right, folks?
Well, you can see this is a more, you can get more real world than this. This is a really a lot of insight about how you get a contract over, you know, years of experiences, right? But last but not least, you have to meet John Marshall, our senior manager for Verizon. You go to all the conferences like I do, you will know that John is always mobbed by everybody in the conference. Not because he's good looking, he's not. Because that he's really the vanguard of all the contracts, you know, with Verizon. So if you want to do business with Verizon, he's the one you have to deal with and learn from. And he became a very popular conference speaker over the years. And I want to, he will have to share with us about what you need to do in terms of how to prepare yourself when you get, before you get in front of the buyer of large corporations like Verizon. So please give a hand to John.
Okay, any questions? You did such a tremendous job.
Right.
Now, what can I say? I mean, any questions? What do you want to hear? These things, this goes up and down and moves all around and all that kind of stuff. But, okay, I think you've kind of heard from the government side, heard from the individual side. Now, corporations, and we're different. Corporations are really different. And we, you know, we do things because of a, more or less a social obligation, something that we have to do. We do it because of government compliance. We do it because it's the right thing to do. But one of the things we want to make sure is, do you do what you do? And a lot of people don't know, you know, how many people are doing business with major corporations? What corporation are you doing business with? You raise your hand, so you know. I'm not happy. I'm
a major media company.
You're a major media company? Yeah. Which one?
You
can't say.
Are
you among friends?
And we'll be videotaped.
Oh! Okay, wait a minute. Turn the camera that way. Which camera? Okay. All right, who else is doing? Where's the other hand? Sir?
I Pfizer, corporate relocation there, Credit Suisse.
Okay. So, also, he's not scared.
Well, I'm proud.
It must be a real legitimate business.
Oh. Okay. All right. Anyone else on this side? I know we have the right wing, we got the left wing. Okay, so everybody doing business with corporate America is on the right wing. Okay. All right, so here's the thing. How difficult is it to do business with major corporations? Now, I even go down and cut it down a lot. How difficult is it to do business with Verizon? Now, one thing you'll find out about me, I am very honest. It is very difficult to do business with Verizon. Okay. Have you ever been in business over 5 years? Have you ever been in business under 1 year? Okay, so have you ever been here in business 2 years? How many people in business in here? Is everybody in business in here, or are you just in here and just sucking the bad air? Okay, that's all right. How many of you approach a major corporation and you wanted to sell to them and you walked away totally frustrated? You put a major media company. You've been so frustrated. I mean, you got a big kind of contract, you know. But a lot of people come up to us and walk away frustrated because, one, they don't have the wherewithal to do business with major corporations. I think during the lunch hour, a gentleman mentioned during lunch, well, let's put it this way. To do business with Verizon, one, you have to have done business for 3 consecutive years at the level of about $1 million. Anybody in here fit that bill? Okay. All right, now I'm finished. No, but that's a cutoff. The second cutoff goes back and says, okay, what is your past performance in doing business with other companies? How well are you doing the job? It's not just references, but it's past performance in doing a job. A major issue that a lot of people fail to realize, and as we go back through looking at questions and coming up and talking to me, is what is it you do? I think it was mentioned here, and it was mentioned in the other room. What is it you really do? A lot of times people will come up and say, I want to work with Verizon, okay? What do you do? And they say, what do you have a contract for? So, well, I don't have any contract for anything, but I do that. And you have to go back and look at it. So if you go back and specify and really look at what you do, you have to be really specific in what you do. Now, dealing with Verizon, you also go back and deal with any major corporation. They're going to ask you some of the same questions that the city asked. They're going to ask you a question about, are you certified? How many people are certified? Now, come on now. No, wait a minute. Everybody in here is not certified. Who's, are you certified now? You certified by who?
What? What do you mean certified?
Ah, no, but you said you're certified.
I am certified, but it depends.
You're certified to do what?
To do interior.
I'm sorry?
Interior improvement.
Okay, but you're certified in the professional arena, is that correct?
Correct.
Okay. Are you certified by any third-party entity that says, are you Asian?
Yes.
You are American Asian?
Yes.
Okay. Are you certified by any organization that says you are a bona fide American Asian organization?
Sort of.
Oh, wait a minute. Sort of don't get you over there now. You got
I'm not by Asian business, by
no,
other
no,
business.
No.
By American business.
By who?
By American business.
Which one?
Gross leader.
Who? That don't count.
What kind of is just
count? No, that don't count. We'll toss that one out.
Okay.
Anybody else certified?
So what kind of company? So the question is, what kind of company?
I'm going to get right there. Okay. I'm going to get to you. I'm going to let you know who you need to be certified. Yes, ma'am. You're back in the cheap seat. So raise your hand and go.
I used to be certified when I had my law practice as a woman-owned business by New York State.
By New York State.
And then I'm certified on the federal level, which is self-certification.
Yeah. No, no, no. Wait a minute. She said self-certification.
I'm not native. I was not native. She's
white.
And I was also certified by the National Women Business Owners Corporation, which deals with many Fortune 500, 1,000 companies like Disney.
Okay, go ahead. This is good.
I was also certified by Nassau County and Suffolk County, which are basically self-certifications.
Okay. Now.
Oh, I forget to mention, I was certified by Better Business Bureau, Down the Bread, and Consumer Fix.
They don't count.
Yeah,
he's doing business with me, they don't count.
Yeah, this is a very important question, so please pay attention.
They don't count. This is it. A lot of people think they're eligible to go do business with major corporations based on some of the certification. Major corporations only recognize state, city, and third-party certification organization. A third-party certification organization is WeBank, okay? The National Minority Supplier Development Council, okay? SBA has their certification. We recognize those, all right? And I think in the process is the U.S. PAC is beginning to look at their certification process. So when you go in and look at certification, because that's the first thing. Corporations, American corporations, do things based on the fact of how much they can get. And in this case, if you're certified and I do business with you, I get a whoopee pin. You know, the government said, hey, oh boy, you're doing good. You go back and you get all the dollars and you get recognized as doing good. Verizon last year alone was certified. And ma'am, not self-certified. Not self-certified, because we as a corporation, and most corporations, do not accept self-certification. Okay? And that's it. But Verizon alone did $3.5 billion worth of business with certified minority suppliers and services able veterans.
So would you accept city certification, or would you require something?
No, I accept it. That's what I said. He's at the state. He's at the state and city level. Right? But if you walk in and tell me you're Asian Pacific, and I'm going to say, give me a certification, you say, I'm self-certified. It's okay, tough. You tell me you're a woman-owned business, and I'm going to say, okay, you want to be a woman-owned business? Do you own and operate 51% of the business? Yeah. Okay, you own an operator? Yeah. You make all the daily decisions? Yeah. Are you certified? No. Then what are you? You're a small business. Yeah, you're a small business. Okay, but when I would go back and look at you, you come to me, and you're going to sell me goods, I'm looking for a certification, or I put you in small business. Now, first thing, I don't need a lot of small business. I don't need a lot of small business. What I need are minority-owned businesses, service-disabled veterans. That's where a lot of your corporations are going. That's where they're looking. That's where the goals are. And when we look at other contractors that do business with us, where's the guy from Pfizer? You know, Pfizer. We in Pfizer, we're doing business with Pfizer. We require Pfizer to do 18% minority business if they're going to get our business. Okay? Now, and my point is this. My real point is this. If you are small, and you don't have the wherewithal to do business with a Verizon, there is nothing wrong with subcontracting. Not everyone can be a prime contractor. I'll go back and answer a question. All right, you do design, right?
Yeah.
What's your limit of liability?
What do you mean limit of liability?
Okay.
You mean
what's your insurance liability?
Yeah, $1 million.
$1 million.
Court?
Ain't enough.
Oh.
Not enough.
That was very general.
Okay.
Okay.
To do business with Verizon?
Tell
limits
us
the liability
enough.
Or how much? $3 million.
Oh, okay.
$3 million umbrella. So you're coming out to shoot? Coming out, and I'm not paying for your insurance. You didn't say, hey, I'll get $3 million, but I'm going to put it in my cost structure when I give you a proposal. I said, tough. You're not going to do that. Because what I'm going to do is get the best price for my company. I'm going to get the best price for the company. So there are some things that you do as a normal cost of doing business. So I think the question was here earlier when we start talking, says, if I want to go and do business with the big guy, I gotta act like the big guy and the big girls. I've gotta have the wherewithal to do business. I can't go in with a Verizon or a major Sears or anybody else, a Shell Oil Company, and talk about I want a $50 million contract and you only have a staff of one. Don't work that way. Even if you had a staff of two. He said, no, I got a staff of two, but I got people I can subcontract to. Then show me your subcontracting management. Show me how you're going to manage that process. Right? See, a lot of people take sales classes, and they say, well, let's talk about sales. We want to talk about I can do that business. So first thing I said, no, you say, oh, yeah, let me take the objection. Well, can you do it? No, I can't do it, but I can do it. But I object. No, but let's look at it a different way. Right? Yes, sir.
You know, what you're really saying is barriers,
I'm saying,
a lot of barriers. Like,
oh, no.
One barrier is, let's say, some companies, let's say on Wall Street, will only qualify companies that are medium cap companies. They won't even consider small cap companies. And plus, you have to be a company that's on some stock exchange throughout the world. Or if you're a coming up company, they got to see how much money you can bring to the table and stuff like that. So the same thing with some of these big companies. But I went to a meeting, it was an economical summit, and it was like maybe only five companies. I think it was PepsiCo, Macy's, and all the other companies. Your company wasn't there, by the way. Guy said, from PepsiCo, he said, all these other major companies, the reason why they're not here to deal with minority businesses, because they don't really... They don't really invest in minority businesses. They like saying that a minority business has to be a minority business that's making $20 million. Now, Black Enterprise has a list of companies, 100 companies in there, And some companies, some of them were making more than 20 million.
Oh, yeah.
And those are the companies that they're looking at say, okay, I want to do this with this Uner. I think there's a guy named Preston Pearson in Dallas. He had baseball hats or whatever. That's the guy they want to deal business with. But a guy in Brooklyn may have a better baseball hat business. They don't want to deal with this guy. They want to deal with the guy Preston Pearson that used to play with the Dallas Cowboys. And his company's supposed to be making.
But yeah, let me
plus
stop.
His company's not saving
money. Yeah, but I'm going to stop you right there because you know what this is all about? You know what we're doing business?
It's politics.
No. You want to put it somewhere else. I want to put it right where it hurts. It's about relationships. It's about establishing a business acumen. It's about getting out there and making a commitment to your business. Not about politics. Politics don't even play
it.
No, wait a minute. No, part of politics is relationship.
But
if you go out and know,
if I'm waiting on you to become a multimillionaire, I'd be waiting forever. I wouldn't make it.
You're absolutely correct.
If I go by my other way of my connections, I'll meet you every 5 years or whatever. Or I might meet you every year and we
But what have you just
friends,
done, sir?
But at the end of the day, you're still not giving me your contract.
I'm not going to give you anything. What I want you to do, just like anybody in this room, is that you're going to have to win my business.
Yeah, because I have to be a business that's making 10 or 20 million.
No, I didn't say that. I've never said that.
Real small business.
But you're taking that out of context.
But I'm on the stock exchange and I'm a small business. I'm not going to worry about
it. Are you a minority small business? You certified as minority business?
But I don't have to do that. I went through all that years ago. We don't work in that channel. We make our money.
Okay.
But we don't have to go through
but
all
you're
that.
In a different business.
Right. We don't have to go through all those
But you're
steps.
In a different business.
Right. We don't have to go through those steps of getting in this.
But I'm going back. You're in a different business. Some of the things that we're going to say to you do not apply to you.
I understand.
Okay. It does not apply to you. You're in a business about making money. You're in a business of lending money. You're in a business of playing in the stock market. You're not going to come to a Verizon to play in the stock market.
The gentleman makes a valid point about scale. That it seems that there's a certain minimum scale, whether it's insurance coverage or number of employees, whatever, that a company like Verizon may demand, and that leaves out a lot of businesses,
sure.
Which is a very legitimate point. You're countering that by saying relationships, so maybe you can expand on what relationships
when I'm saying
beyond specific criteria like $3 million of insurance.
Let me go. $3 million is not a relationship. If you go in and you got people, a lot of people are afraid to go into a major corporation because you know why? It takes time to do business and close a deal. Okay, it takes time. A lot of people want to walk in and visit a major corporation and say, I'm here. Here's my credentials. I lay them on the table. I want your money now. Okay? I'm not going to do that. No major corporation will do that. Even the person I'm here to talk about in the banking industry, you're going to have some sort of relationship. You're going to have to show that you have a wherewithal, one, to do what I want you to do. Two, with the bank, you got to show the wherewithal, you got the amount of money to pay me back if I'm going to give you the money. You got to go back and look at a business plan. You got to go through all of the process. There are no set-asides in corporate America. Federal government has them. Okay? Federal government has them. Corporate America does not have set-asides.
But it goes by, you get in where you fit. Because, for instance, there are certain companies, they might be small today, they might become bigger.
You're absolutely
they
correct.
Might get successful.
Black Enterprise and one.
And they may not need a Verizon, and they're not going to go. They may go through the new steps in the government. The
there's
government
a problem,
may have programs.
But there's a lot of people in this room don't need a Verizon.
Right, that's true.
Okay, there's a whole bunch of people in this room will never even want to even deal with a Verizon.
But just in case we want to deal with a Verizon and you were getting to a point.
The point is, if you're going to deal with a Verizon, you're going to have the credentials. You're going to have the certification. You're going to have a technology or a service. Verizon is a telecommunications company. Their primary business is technology. If you're doing basket weaving, don't come in to me. If you're doing technology, come on in. Let's sit down and talk. You make phones, you're doing something in the communication technology. But what I'm saying, not just with Verizon, but any corporation that you're going to go work with, you want to identify what are your capabilities and your services to that corporation.
Exactly. Every corporation is different. Those
every corporation
rules.
Is different.
Not everybody
you know.
Has rules
got followed. And now, and that's just it. And I, I'm not trying to browbeat anybody. All I'm saying is that most corporations are going to look at, do you have the wherewithal to do the business of what they do? Are you looking at doing the same things that they want to do? Can you make them? Here's the thing. Here's the big thing today in America. Going and doing business with a major corporation is how much money are you going to save that corporation by doing business? What is a cost saving?
But it's also okay. Expertise. I mean, I might be able to deal with a company like Cisco, which is a major corporation, before I can deal with a Verizon. And what I'm doing is something what Cisco wants, what they need, you know, want to deal with. And it's expertise because they got the people there that are right in line with what that
it's
is.
Technology.
And so it's a different, as they say.
But you know, you know what I'd like to do? I'll take you to dinner today, and we'll have a long conversation. Okay? No. I'll take you to dinner tonight, and I'll miss my train. I'll miss my train and take you to dinner, and we can just jam all night.
All right.
Now,
I'm
free,
Mark.
No. You want to tell me you work for?
Yeah, that's right.
Yes, ma'am. And you can design anything you want me to do.
Okay.
Yeah. But what I'm saying to you,
I'll do dinner for the first hour of your dinner.
Oh, we're gonna flip to see who's gonna pay. I mean, he's got all this capital money. We might go ahead and flip the coin.
And
yes, sir.
Come back as a guest too for the dinner.
You got some money?
I think you're paying
it. You got some money?
Verizon is paying it.
You got, hey, you flip too. You may end up paying. Now, you have a question? Now, all I'm saying to you, ladies and gentlemen, is doing business with corporate America is not the same as doing business with the local grocery store.
Of course.
Okay? Doing business with corporate America, first of all, I mean, just even look at, even though I don't know what the city, sometimes cities might have fast tracks. But when you look at going into business in a major corporation, they're going to go out net 45. Net 45 is when you're paid. You might get, and that's best, if you're lucky, it's net 45. You might end up getting net 60 and net 90. And the net 45 is after they approve your invoice. Your invoice might take up to 20 days to get approved.
If you put it in right. That's right.
So you've got to have something in the kitty to hold you through if you're going. If you're dependent on, I know right now where some companies, small businesses, have 70% of their business with us. If we stop today, they stop forever. Okay? And that was a business decision that they made because they came after Verizon. Right, so you got the technology, what I want to do, fine, we'll take it. Wire, when they get it from copper to fiber, people rolled out down to Verizon and selling reels of fiber, reels of copper. And you know where that copper is sitting right now? In their yard. Because where they are now, they're in fiber. Now, was that a good business decision? It sure was when they first went in there. The money was rolling. And all of a sudden, technology changed. So you've got to be on the leading edge of technology. You've got to be flexible. Everybody says small businesses are flexible. I tell you what, corporations like Verizon, Pfizer, Sears, all of them are going to make you show that flexibility. But they'll stop on a dime.
Jump through hoops, fine.
You'll go through it. That's right. So the challenge is make sure you select in your business line where you want to go. If you're in a certain business, you have that business, if it mirrors what you do, then fine, build that relationship. Stay with those folks. Understand it. Build a relationship. I have people come to me and have been to almost every one of my seminars. It took one company 7 years for me to get them business. And it was a relationship. I get a phone call once a month from this one company, every month. It's just like clockwork. Hey, how we doing today? I'm fine. Got anything for me? No, not yet, but I'm working on it. But when I get it, I got them in mind. That's a relationship. There's a difference between being assertive and being aggressive. If you're aggressive, you ain't getting jacked. If you're assertive and you can demonstrate to me that you have the wherewithal to do it, I'm your best friend. Now, wait a minute. And my last point right now, I will not market for anyone out here, including you. Okay? And the reason is, I don't get paid to market for you. I'm not on your payroll. My job is to move obstacles out of the way that are created when you get inside or you understand. If you tell me you have an obstacle, that's my job. I'll move it out of the way. It is not for me to pass out your business card. It is for you to convince me that you have the capability of doing what I want to have done.
What about networking?
Networking? This is a networking session. Take advantage of it.
Right, of course.
Okay.
I mean,
I'm inviting you to dinner. I'm taking you to dinner. You want to network? Okay. I might not give you a knife, fork, and spoon. But I'm taking you to dinner.
Thank you. Well, we're running out of time, but it's very true that, you know, if you want to do business with Verizon, Fortune 500 companies or other major corporations or New York State, federal, you have to get certified, you have to get ready and do your homework, know what it takes, and people like that will be very meaningful to you to get to know and people to speak with them. So I think it's very important to know, and it's level KY also, about how, what it takes after years of persistence and preparations about how you can get in front of those major projects and get business from there. So it's not easy. It's about continuous education. It's about knowing the landscape. It's about getting certified with the right associations, with the right organizations. And you have to know the basic know-how. And I hope today give you some basic foundation of that. And for those of you want to learn more, I think we have some information for you to give the PowerPoint you pick from them. And some commercial for me also, we have a two full day conference in New York next month on May 20th to 22nd. It's a 2 full day conference where we have about 100 Fortune 500 companies, the buyers and the managers, including John,
will be there
to meet with you face to face personally and educate you about what to do, how to do. And so I have some postcards here up front if you want to learn more about this. But good luck, and they'll be here for a little bit. Go ahead.
I just want to make two announcements. Well, all of the people in the room who are not in business, out on the table is this slide, is this pamphlet here. This pamphlet here is for the New York City Department of Small Business Services Business Solutions Center. These centers are strategically located throughout every borough. You can go in, and they will help you start your business from A to Z, whether it's business plan writing, marketing, how to start a business, is licensing, permits. You go to the city's website, they will teach you about how to go about getting your permit at the New York City Business Express. This is at no cost to you. All of this is a little bit of sweat equity. You just need to type this in, make an appointment, go in and see someone. All of you who are in business today, although we didn't go into things very, very deeply, but we really hit them generically, this is a step-by-step guide on how to sell to the city of New York, what the city of New York is looking for, and everything that you need. Most of this stuff applies to the city, the state. Some things may apply to John, but again, as we said, things are different. I think the most important thing that I can tell you to take away from here today is to know your business, know what your capability is, know whether or not you want to even enter into this arena. But if you do, do your homework. Because the more knowledgeable you are, the greater the chance of you of getting some work with the city of New York.
Well, thank you. Again, I want to give a big hand to the panelists.